We're going to talk about cardiac compromise. The objectives: list the signs and symptoms of cardiopulmonary distress, respond to the signs and symptoms of cardiopulmonary distress, identify major variances to waveforms related to ischemia, injury, or infarction, recognize life-threatening arrhythmias, state the proper response for life-threatening arrhythmias. Signs and symptoms of cardiopulmonary distress: abnormal heart rate, abnormal blood pressure, tachypnea, bradypnea, dyspnea or shallow respirations, pallor, diaphoresis, which is excessive sweating, anxiety or confusion, cyanosis, shortness of breath, chest pain that radiates to the back, arms or jaw, chest tightness or a squeezing sensation, nausea, vomiting, lightheadedness, weakness, syncope, or fainting. Responding to cardiopulmonary distress: immediately notify the physician if the patient exhibits any of these symptoms before, during, or after the stress test. Place the patient in a comfortable position. Ischemia, injury, and infarction. Three key ECG indicators of myocardial ischemia, injury, and infarction are: 1. Changes in T wave, either peaking or inversion. 2. Changes in ST segment, either depression or elevation. And 3. Enlarged Q waves or appearance of new Q waves. You will usually see all three changes during an MI, but any one of these changes may occur by itself. Ischemia may be transient, such as angina, or it can be related to MI. The J point. This is the junction point between the QRS complex and the ST segment. You can see that right here. It signifies the end of ventricular depolarization and the beginning of ventricular repolarization. Think of acute myocardial injury and infarction as a problem of repolarization. This will prompt you to look for anomalies on the right side of the QRS complex. J point abnormalities. Normal. The J point is on the isoelectric line, as you can see here. Depressed. The J point is below the isoelectric line. Actually, this is a 4 millimeter depression, because you count the small squares. And elevated, this is a J point above the isoelectric line. So again, look at it in relation to the isoelectric line. Note, for an ST segment to be abnormal, there must be a change of greater than 2 millimeters or 2 small squares vertically. Ischemia and myocardial injury. Myocardial ischemia is the obstruction of blood flow to the heart. Classic pattern is ST segment depression or T wave inversion. This is your ST depression, and theirs is inverted. An NSTEMI is non-ST elevation myocardial infarction, so this is not elevated. Myocardial injury is injury due to obstruction of blood flow to the heart. The classic pattern for that is ST segment elevation or STEMI, ST elevation myocardial infarction, and there's your ST elevation. STEMI is diagnosed using the following criteria: ST segment elevation and 2 or more contiguous leads. That just means back to back. Limb lead greater than 1 millimeter, precordial leads greater than 2 millimeters, and reciprocal changes may be present. Reciprocal changes are changes that occur as a result of opposing view angles between the leads. Now, there are several reciprocal changes, but the ones that I really want you to know are the leads 1, 2 in AVF, which is an inferior view, and 1 and AVL, okay? And I'm sorry, those are lateral views. So what this means is, you see this ST elevation in lead 3, it's elevated like here, and then in here it's below the isoelectric line, it's inverted. Reciprocal changes are highly confirmatory for acute ischemic or injury events. Myocardial infarction is the death of myocardial tissue due to ischemia. Two main ECG changes observed 2 days to weeks after MI. Complete resolution and normalization of the tracing and the persistence of a pathologic Q wave. So this is the sequence. It goes from normal to acute hours after, 1 to 2 days, days later, and then a week later. See, by a week, we've got everything else is normalized except this Q wave right here. And this is a pathologic Q wave. It's greater than 0.04 seconds. And the depression is greater than 25% of the R. So let's say the R is 10 millimeters high. Then if this is greater than 2.5 millimeters, then that's a pathologic Q wave. Abnormal T waves, they can be inverted. Deeply inverted T waves are a frequently encountered presentation of ischemia. And these hyperacute T waves is an indicator of anterior STEMI. The height of the T wave is greater than half the overall height of the QRS, symmetrical with respect to the Y axis, and the base of the T wave broadens. And again, there's that abnormal QRS. It's actually the same picture. Now, these are both examples of ST elevation. This one is concave. It goes in, it has like a little smiley face. These are usually benign, particularly when it occurs in an otherwise healthy, asymptomatic patient. This one is convex. And more often associated with an acute injury pattern. Some examples of life-threatening arrhythmias: ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation, asystole, torsades de pointe, which is a type of polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, pulseless electrical activity, and third-degree AV block. How can you help as an ECG tech? Two of the most important interventions for cardiac arrest are high quality CPR and early defibrillation. To respond to potentially life-threatening arrhythmias, first of all, you need to recognize the lethal rhythm. Call for help using established guidelines at your institution. Initiate CPR ASAP. Notify emergency services. Have someone retrieve the AED, automated external defibrillator, and be prepared to assist with other tasks. Now, these are some arrhythmias of concern. The first one is ventricular fibrillation. This is a disorganized, chaotic, non-perfusing, and lethal arrhythmia. Patients often experience symptoms such as dizziness, feelings of impending doom, chest discomfort, and shortness of breath immediately before the arrest or at the time of arrest. In ventricular tachycardia, this is an organized ventricular rhythm that often results in a precipitous drop in blood pressure and level of consciousness. VTAC may continue to produce a pulse, but often deteriorates to a pulseless rhythm or ventricular fibrillation. It has the same symptoms as VFib. Asystole is a complete cessation of electrical activity in the heart. Common causes of asystole include large pulmonary embolism, large MI, respiratory arrest, hypoxia, and overdose. Note, patients may not complain of any symptoms prior to the arrest. Bradycardia is a slow heart rate. It's less than 60 beats per minute. Recognize when vital signs fall outside of unexpected parameters. So your responsibilities would be to notify the physician, monitor patient until care is transferred, and assist with placing pads on patients. And the last one is tachycardia. This is a fast heart rate, or greater than 100 beats per minute, and it's the same responsibilities as you would have with bradycardia.